that you want him to do you so much you could do anything.
Hey guys, just checking out this new GoPro camera, trying to figure out how to use it, what the features are and all this other stuff. I'm not down with this technology. Everything to this point has been done on the iPhone or through different little apps and stuff like that, so trying to get with the times. So,
woo! It's a beautiful day here in Ohio. Loading a three-stop load going down to Alabama. For Monday morning, and then doing a reload, going up to Mississippi, then back up to Ohio. Woo! We got plenty of time on this joint, so it's all good in the hood. So how's everyone's day going? It's Friday. You know, when you drive a truck, it doesn't matter if it's Friday, Sunday, it's all the same, isn't it? I'll check back in a little while. Wow, what a sad day. I knew that DMX, the rapper, he was going through some problems. When we had the towing company, we actually did work for his organization and also through HBO Studios. I never actually physically like hung out with him, but I did. I was in the same place with him a couple times. I did see him, and he was aware. What happened was GM did a Rough Rider truck. I think that was back in like 2009 or 2010. And we had to pick this truck up from his house. He lived in the same town as me. He had like a vacation home. Beautiful home, big pond. I mean, the essential rich rapper. Pit bulls all over the place. Multiple people staying up. It was always like a party. And they were really good guys. And they had all sorts of hot rods, motorcycles. And he was real big. He had a crew called the Rough Riders, which was like a motorcycle, like an MC. It was all like street bikes, doing tricks and stuff. And actually one of the guys that used to work for me actually rode with them guys. They were hardcore riders, but I knew DMX had, he was like in a coma or an induced coma because he had something going on with his heart, but then I just heard that he passed away today at 50 years old. And that guy, I know rap isn't everyone's genre of music. I like all kinds of music, country, rap, classical. If it's music, I like it. And it just, how sad, man. That guy turned his life around, found God, was talking about Jesus, like, trying to do the next right thing, and this was supposed to be his last album, and I guess it was going to be his retirement money. You know, I guess when the music industry, the way it works, you know, you got to pay for all your own touring, you got to pay for promoting this, promoting that, tour bus this, tour bus that, and you make it back with concert venues and with record sales. What they actually do is if you get a $5 million deal, it could be a two record deal, but that $5 million goes quick because you spend it on yourself and then you got to self-promote and then they take back that money. It's kind of like a note. So that's why it's like, it's designed, if you listen to some of these artists that say, you know, like if you look at TLC back in the day, they had that awesome album that had Waterfalls on it and everything like that, and all of them were broke. They broke record sales, gold and platinum album, and blah, 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 millions and millions of dollars, and they were rich for a minute and then had to sign the money right back over to the music company to pay for all the advances they had taken. It's just real, you know, we're truck drivers and we're gonna say this is grimy, but that's even grimier because you put your heart and soul into something and then whoosh, it's gone. But homeboy was getting it right, found God. This was gonna be his last album, was focusing on his kids. He had a couple older kids and stuff like that. And when I heard he straightened out his act, I mean, a lot of times we'd get sent by his company because he also lived over in Westchester County. And he had so many cars, and he'd get pulled over, say, on 684, and we'd have to go get the car out of police impound because it didn't either have registration or expired registration or it didn't have insurance. It was always something, but I guess when you have that many vehicles, it is what it is. But what a sad day. Definitely DMX. He had some powerful music and was also an artist with his rhymes and speaking of the truth, when it comes to Jesus and God and all that stuff. But yeah, my heart goes out to him and his family. Prayers to him and his family. So we've been sitting here since like 12:15, got a door right away, and it's supposed to be a three-stop load. They finally, I just felt the truck rock. I got my red light. They must have locked me into the dock, but they're not breaking any land records here. Originally, it was a 5 o'clock appointment. The broker said, just go right over. Your road's, the load's all ready. Just go right over. That's the thing that gets me crazy, because now I came over, and now it's like they're going to load me at 5 o'clock, but I could have done something else in the meantime. You know what I mean? Could have gotten a shower, took the truck to go get washed, could have taken a nap, but I figured I was going to get a good jump on it and go, and now my clock is running. So, I mean, we got plenty of time. We got to be in Alabama. The first drop is for 0800 on Monday. From here, this is Willard, Ohio. With all three stops, I got 866 miles. So, pretty much, I'll run the clock down. Probably end up in Kentucky tonight. Wake up, shower, take my break, and then I'll be sitting all day. And I took a look at the facility. I should be able to get on. If not, there is a truck stop, like a little no-name truck stop, down off 65 where I'm going. So that's my whole situation, man. Fantastic Friday, they said. Let's sit around. Run. Let's go sit around. Get loaded. Run. Sit around. Get unloaded. Run. Yeah, it's like, it's monotony, man. It's absolute monotony. Whew. Gotta take up wigwaming or something. Yeah, so I saw last night, little Viking coach, he's actually gonna start a fast. He was gonna do a 48-hour fast, I think he said. I saw it on one of his videos, and I had really good success with the fast I had done 3 weekends ago. I only did the 24 hours. I was going to stretch it in, try to do 2 days, but I'm a big boy, man. I have to prepare a little bit more, but I was going to start today, and I was going to do a two-day. In essence, I actually had a muscle milk this morning and a banana. I completely forgot about it, so I'm going to send him a message, and I'm going to reach out also for my monk friend, old recap, and I'm probably gonna run it down. So I'll fast all day tomorrow, all day Sunday, and then I'll eat Monday morning when I make that first drop. So looking forward to it. But let me tell you something, the fasting, really, if you're fasting and using it for like spirituality purposes, also it's good for jump start of a diet. If you're trying to lean down, like I said, I want to drop 40-50 pounds, I'll do it. It's just, it's hard being out here on the road. That's why, like, the fridge is stocked, you got the cookery, and do what we got to do. Pony actually did a good job. Oh, we're getting loaded. How about that? Pony did a good job stocking me up, and I got all healthy stuff, so there really is no excuse. But, and Beetle Bailey saved my hide so many times with that electric teapot thing. You put the water in it, and within a minute, it's boiled. So I usually go a little longer than a minute, because some of the noodle things have really got to take a little bit more to get it going. But all that stuff, it's not terrible for you, but there's so much sodium in it. Me being a big guy anyhow, I'm going to retain more water. And then, you know, I notice after I have like one of those ramen noodles later on, I'll be thirsty as heck. But that's, you know, it's doing its thing. So just try to be a little objective on what you do. But definitely the spiritual, doing a fast and praying for somebody, because when I did my first fast, I got immediate answers to a lot of things that I was soul searching for. You know, it's like making these great changes, man. It feels good. It's not easy. You know, it's not easy. People, like I said, will try to throw comments at you or, you know, do weak stuff. But it's kind of like I almost appreciate it, because the minute I get upset or I get mad about it, then I'm like, I still got to continue to work. So it's like all these things are put in your face for a reason, especially if you're serious about making changes and doing good things. And it's not easy. We all say that we're spiritual and we're all supposed to be Christian and stuff like that, but it's cool that you could say, like, for years I said I was spiritual, and I studied the Bible. And when I first had Madison, I was kind of on a good course, and then just with the type of lifestyle and the stuff I had going on, it just kind of slid by the wayside. And I almost became a baptized Jehovah Witness, and they told me I had to shave my beard. They were awesome people, peaceful people. They helped me. They used to come study the Bible with me twice a week. I'd go to Kingdom Hall, dress up in a suit, and I correlate suit to something terrible. It's either funeral, court, you know. So like wearing a suit, like I had so much anxiety about putting a suit on and all that other stuff, but I was able to get through it. I prayed on it, got through it, but I took the test. Like, that you sit down with the elders and they ask you like Bible-based questions, And they actually did a story on me. And it was kind of cool. But when they said, okay, we're going to set you up, you know, for the date, you're going to be baptized and blah, 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 you got to shave your beard. I was like, what? So I don't want to put any bad juju on their organization because they are awesome people. As a matter of fact, one of my old Bible guys actually texted me and actually sent me some stuff in the mail. And they're really awesome people. But they said I couldn't become baptized because of the hair on the face. I said, well, just like you taught me, you said everything about your organization is based in the Bible. Where does it say in the Bible that I can't have a beard? And they showed me where you're not supposed to be tattooed, piercings, earrings, all that stuff, smoking, drunkards. You know, 2 Timothy has a whole thing about, you know, even overeating is a sin, believe it or not. All these things. They couldn't pull it up, though. They couldn't pull it up. And then finally they got back to me and they were like, yeah, yeah, that's from the secret and discreet slave. That's like the governing body for that runs all the Jehovah's Witnesses. They just don't want us to have facial hair. So like, if you knock on someone's door, they're not going to assimilate you to the hippie movement. I'm like, that was like, what are you even talking about? I'm like, you know, a few years back, if you had a tattoo, you were, you know, you're a prisoner. You were so many bad things, but tattoos is just the way society has changed. It's not a big deal. Like, I don't understand. And they say, oh, the secret discreet slaves, they got to be clean shaven. And I said, absolutely not. I said, tell the secret discreet slave that when they change their mind, let me know and they'll consider getting baptized. I said, other than that. And I went through a whole thing. I felt so much guilt. And I was like, oh, if it's for God, I'll just shave my beard. But I, like, my gut was telling me, like, no, this is the wrong thing to do. This is the wrong thing to do. You know, obviously, having a beard, how can that be, you know, traumatic and terrible? Jesus had a beard, for Christ's sakes. You know, all the people back in the Bible days, that beards was what you had, you know? So I didn't understand it, but it's crazy. It's just absolutely crazy. So that's my beard story for Friday.
6 hours and 10 minutes of hang time. And we cleaned the heck out of the inside of the truck. Ba-bang. I think it's the lawnmowers. Yep. Lawnmowers. These guys got jokes. Truckerwild. I'd rather have a snapper. You like the snapper? Yeah. Snapper.
Now I'm going to get some kind of crap because the security guard was supposed to put the seal on. He's throwing his hands in the air. But he wanted to sit there. So I did it. Do your job. Think I want to put the seal on because like it gets me off? No, I want to go. So let's see how this goes. I can tell he's a very angry individual. I can just tell. Are you gonna wave at me or? Oh, what a tool. These are the moments I try, man. Good? I gotta go out. Go figure. You know what? I'm just cranky because I've been sitting here. He kind of got under my skin, but he even said, he goes, oh man, he goes, you were the first one on this page. He goes, you've been here for a while. I said, yeah, yeah, I said, the broker said, the loader's ready, I can head right down. I was gonna get loaded early. It says almost 7 hours ago. I said, now it jacks me up with my clock, but whatever, I got plenty of time on it. The example, don't take the bait. I will see you in a little while.
Check this out. Look how awesome that is. There's a rainbow just coming up out of the sky. Not a traditional rainbow. It's like, it's crazy. Look how beautiful that is.
So we are just outside Kentucky. There's a Flying J over here. I stayed at it about a month and a half ago. It's over in Jeffersonville. Actually, someone from my company had to come out and fix. They had swapped my ELD device while I was up here. Gonna go get some country fried steak. Yeah. And gonna lay down. I got so much time on this load, and gonna be sitting around, so tomorrow will be a nice easy trot in or whatever. So I'm gonna try and hit up a CB shop, grab something that's gonna fit up there in the cuddy hole, something with some kind of power. So, Flying J's wide open here. It's actually a cleaner style Flying J. You know how them things go. So, all right, we'll do our thing. See you guys later.
You think Sammy from Make Sense knows they took his truck and put it on the wall at Denny's? Saying. Ooh, Sammy gonna be mad.
Woo!
All right. Denny's was good. Punch fried steak. Mashed potatoes. I got some broccoli. It was good. Ooh, it was actually really fresh. It was clean in there. They were just understaffed. They said that because of the, you know, the virus, nobody wants to work, they said. Imagine that. But all in all, good day. So, live from Kentucky, Truckerwild telling you for today, always keep God first, love your wife, and your family and friends. It's the first and last time you'll ever see them. Usually things come into play. Talk to you tomorrow. Love you all. Thanks for taking the journey. I'll see you later.